Hello, everyone. How are you guys doing? They have me rigged up with this thing around my face, and it makes me feel like I'm going to sell some OxyClean or something. Really, I am. No, just kidding. Cybeta's selling it, so I'm not going to step on their thing. Can we grab the lights, please? Hey. So that's about all you're going to see of that. Okay, so my name is Tim Franklin. We can get the lights back up. I am just retired about 2 months ago, long enough to grow this beard, from Department of Veterans Affairs as a police supervisor, a sergeant. Grand total between the military and civilian law enforcement, I've spent 23 years of my life doing that. I was a special agent with the U.S. Secret Service. Did that for about 6 years. I served under President Clinton, President G.W. Bush, we call him 43, and then finally under President Reagan, Mrs. Reagan, just before he passed away. I was her bodyguard and driver. So I started my career writing parking tickets at a college, Cal State Long Beach, and went to the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Academy back in 1990. Once I graduated from there, I went to work for the Anaheim Police Department as a beat cop, a rookie, a young kid. And I guess I shouldn't say young kid because all you guys are my age when I started, most of you. And that was probably Anaheim Police Department, not probably, it was really a coming of age for me because I learned how to deal with conflict. I learned how to deal with people. I learned what's important and what's not. I, got to see a lot of things up close and personal that I'd never seen before. I grew up in a military family, and I wouldn't say lived a sheltered childhood, but I certainly wasn't a rabble-rouser. You know, graduated from high school with 44 people, and so when I hit the streets of Anaheim, I was a lot thinner than I am now, and I really, really enjoyed myself. My big thing there, especially my first year as soon as I got out of training, was if you were driving with your bright lights on and I was working a night shift, you got a ticket. It's not important. So the thing that really prepared me for this career I've led, and I got my commission in the Air Force in 1993. I was a satellite operations officer, so I flew GPS satellites and a couple of research and development satellites out in Colorado. I was a deep space radar crew commander out on Cape Cod, and so I went from science nerd techie to a different version of science nerd techie. So I really had a great career. I've enjoyed myself, and now it's time to make a transition. So I've been where you are. I went to a community college. In fact, I went to this community college. As I was spinning up for my doctorate program, I had to get some prereqs out of the way. I was a member of Psi Beta. The first community college instructor that I had was Ed Lipinski, and I barely got a B. So in stats, I hate numbers. So, you know, a couple of things we're going to talk about tonight is a passion of mine, and that's studying the human experience. And that's watching people. I love to watch people. I like to stare at people. I like to make them feel uncomfortable. And it works very well in an interview and interrogation type setting. As I learned of this love for watching people, I decided to do it for a living. And that's one of the reasons why I went to the U.S. Secret Service. I was getting out of the Air Force. I missed law enforcement. I wanted to go back. So I applied for every place I could think of, Los Angeles PD. I applied back at Anaheim, San Diego, U.S. Marshals, DEA, number of places. And I said to myself, whoever picks me up first is the agency that I'll go with. And Secret Service was the one that did it, followed a couple weeks later by a few others. But Secret Service was really my first choice. I didn't know anything about it. As a police officer, I'd worked a campaign stop for Bush 41, who was dad, as a uniformed officer. I was up near the podium, and there was a young agent there, a little bit older than me, and got to talk to him, and wow, I thought that is really cool. So that kind of stuck in my mind. So professional people watching. I wanted to know how, first of all, they were going to train me to run toward a gunfight and not away. Do we have any veterans in the audience? Veterans Day is coming up. Thank you very much for your service. I really appreciate it. I really do. So you guys know what it's like, you know, and you know how they train you. But in a Secret Service situation, it's really hard to think that you're going to run toward a bullet and away from it, that it's a natural response to run into harm's way. But they did it, and it's through muscle memory, which I don't have a lot of anymore, and it's through good training, and it's through knowing your environment, knowing exactly what you're looking for, and to predict what you're looking for, and when it's going to happen, how it's going to happen, to trust your intuition. And that is the subject matter of my doctoral research. I got a master's degree in forensic psychology. In April, I get another one in clinical psychology. And I'm getting my doctorate in clinical psychology, and I'm doing a subspecialty in neuropsychology. So right now, I'm working with folks who have been brain injured. They have acquired brain injury, which means that they got in a car wreck or they fell out of a tree or, you know, they got in a gunfight themselves. And I'm learning how to rehabilitate them as much as they can be rehabilitated. And that, too, is people watching. I'm people watching right now. You know, I'm looking around the audience, and I'm looking at everybody's eyes, trying to figure out what all is going on up in there, wondering why the room is so full and why it's so hot up here. Is it hot out there? Okay, good. I don't feel dumb then. Excuse me while I take a drink of water here. So how can we tell a bad guy or gal from a good guy? If you stand up in front of a podium like this, and you're standing off to stage right or to stage left, and the President of the United States is standing here, and he's giving a speech, and any of you have ill intent, and I'm paying attention, that's a key, I'll talk about that in a second, I can pick you out of a crowd like that, really fast. And you can do it, too, with relatively little training. Because the things that I'm looking for behind my glasses or my sunglasses or whatever is I'm looking for something that's just slightly different. And I'm feeling for that gut feeling. Now, we'll see a few videos here in a little bit where there was two assassination attempts against President Ford that I'll show. And we'll see together if we can pick out of that crowd exactly what's going on. But what I'm looking for here is I'm looking for somebody that isn't paying attention or somebody that, you know, I'm not talking about texting your girlfriend or boyfriend or husband or wife. I'm looking for somebody that has ill intent to come up here and harm this crowd or harm us. And the way that we can tell is that just super subtle difference, that sixth sense. And what that sixth sense is it's a collaboration of all your other senses, the five that we have. We can see, I can look at you, I can hear you, I'm not going to taste you, and hopefully I don't smell you. And, you know, we have our tactile sense. Those are our five senses. And so You know, I have a few friends out here that are from the university. I'm not going to call them out. But they know a lot about law enforcement as well. And they will tell you, just as much as I will, that when I would walk up to a police scene and I'm sizing something up, you never run into a gunfight. You always walk, generally, right? To the veterans out there. As I'm walking into a situation, I'm looking for all of the information that I can take in, everything. I'm listening, I'm seeing, and I'm really paying attention to everything that I can get. Now, the brain is going to filter out. It has an enormous capacity once it's trained, but it's still going to filter out well over 99% of the stimulus that's coming in. For example, if I'm looking around the crowd right now and I look at somebody, I can't see what's going on over here. It's still in my peripheral vision, but my brain is filtering it out and I'm not seeing a person in a black shirt over there that may be waving at me. Now, if something catches my attention, I'll shift my attention. But then it's over here, and I don't see what's going on over there. We call that a multi-stimulus environment. So as we're walking up and we're sizing up a situation, and a guy is, say, intoxicated, and he wants to fight us, I can tell you right away, with a good degree of certainty, whether this person is full of hot air, and it's just going to take some verbal de-escalation, or if this person's going to be somebody that we're going to have to fight. And I take a totally different approach with each one of those. Same thing in the Secret Service, those sixth sense. I'm going to tell a lot of stories through here, and we are going to have question and answer at the end, so if you have questions, I'll be happy to answer them. I was with President Clinton just after he left office, and we took him on a trip to London. He went on to Paris and to Athens, and then was going to go to Ireland to do some golfing. So I started out in London, and then we did a jump team, and we went ahead to Ireland to advance all the venues that he was going to be at there. We started in Belfast. We went up to a little town called Derry, which is where the IRA is headquartered. And then from Derry, we were going to motorcade down to Dublin, a couple hours drive. We had British SAS with us, which is their special forces. We had the British version of the Secret Service. I think they're MI5. And we had, of course, our own people. So we went into Ireland, and we landed and, you know, 75 pounds lighter and cut in a fine suit. I got off that airplane. I'm like, oh, yeah, I dominate the world. I know exactly what's happening here. Wrong. I got off the airplane, and we went for, first thing I did was go for a Guinness, see what a proper Guinness tastes like. It's better. It's true. Once the president landed and we got him in the car, which was a couple days later, we went up to Derry, and we went to this medieval complex, which was now a college. And the audience was about as big as this room, about 200 plus people. And I was standing stage right. And the president was speaking to the IRA. Jerry Adams was there, and you know, a few of the other folks in the IRA. And of course, if you follow history, you know that President Clinton is one of the ones that helped broker a peace accord with the IRA. And so my radar is not up and running super hard, because everybody that came through the door had been been run over with a hand wand, the magnetometer. And so I'm just kind of sitting there. I'd heard this speech before, and I wasn't really interested in listening to it again. So I was just people watching. I was looking out into the crowd. And the president was talking about his various exploits, and he started doing this. He said, and because of our work and because of what I've done, there are no more bombs. No more bombs will go off. And all of a sudden, you hear a boom outside. The windows rattle a little bit. We all take a collective deep breath. The lights went out. How's that for timing? And Oh, darn it. My earpiece crackled, and they said, we found a car bomb along the motorcade route. And we blew it up in place, you know. Now, there was a lot of crosstalk before this, but they kept our channel clear so that if something big happened, we could, the people immediately around the president, we could all talk to each other. So everybody else, all the support staff, were on a different channel. So pucker factor goes up a little bit. We heard the detail leader who was in charge come over the radio and say, we're going to remain in place. We know that this building is safe. While we send an investigative team out, we are going to stay put. And the president kept on talking as if nothing had happened. I'm like, wow, okay. So we get him in his armored minivan, and that was one sweet ride. I think every parent needs one. And we motorcaded through Belfast, and we went on down to the border, to Ireland, and he was going to play 18 holes of golf and have some more meetings. So my job was to get out about two holes ahead of him with some plainclothes guys, kind of clear the course if anybody was playing, and this is one of these world-class courses. And now I've let my guard down again because I don't see anything. The golf course is right on the edge of a cliff, and the waves are crashing up against there. It's nice and crisp in the air like I wish it was in here. And beautiful, beautiful green. And so I'm just chit-chatting with the guy next to me, and my earpiece crackles again. And when it crackles, I hate that because you're not supposed to talk unless something's going on. What intelligence told us was that they were going to blow us up with an RPG, a rocket-propelled grenade, as we went over the border. There were some people that wanted to do us some harm. And we, as agents of the Special U.S. Secret Service, we had a couple of FBI guys with us. We had some presidential staffers. He still gets staffers once he got out of office. And, of course, the president himself, they're not attacking Bill Clinton. They're not attacking Tim Franklin. They were attacking the United States of America. Because when you're with a sitting president, if that person is killed, or even a former president, it changes the course of history, literally. It changes the course of history. So we take it very seriously. So what happened was the Brits flew this gigantic cargo helicopter in, and they landed it near the golf course, and we got all of our stuff out of the motorcade, and we got onto the helicopter. And I went into the very back of the helicopter near where all the bags were, and I took out my video camera. I'd been fired if they'd known this. And I put it on top of a bag, and I push play, or not play, record. And the president, before the rotor started turning, was standing right outside the door, and he was talking on his cell phone. And he handed it off to an aide, and they had some kind of colorful conversation with some words that I've since learned. Pretty cool. And the president acted like nothing was going on. He stepped on board the helicopter. He went over to his seat. He pulled out a famous cigar that he never smoked. He started chewing on the end of it, and he looks around the helicopter as we're lifting off, and he pointed at three people, motioned them over. So they got up out of their seats, and they went over to where he was, and he pulled a deck of cards out of his jacket and played poker all the way down there. Thankfully, it wasn't strip poker. I cracked myself up. So the president didn't care. And so it was our job to care for him. He knew that everything was taken care of. He knew that regardless of what was going to happen, we were going to do everything under the sun to protect him. And we had to protect the person. We had to protect the office of the presidency. We did not protect Bill Clinton. He was the person we happened to be with, but we protected the piece of history itself. And so that's how, as a special agent, regardless of your political leanings, we're supposed to be apolitical. We're not supposed to have any opinions about anything, but let me tell you, we do, because we see these folks at their best, and we see them at their worst. We see them when they're shouting and screaming, and the minute that a television camera turns on, we see them turn real sweet, real nice. Hillary Clinton is very good about that. She's going to run for president. So, it was the weight of the world on our shoulders. You know, when I got out of the Air Force, I was a young captain. I'd had a couple of years under my belt working the streets of Anaheim, and I slipped through the cracks and got hired somehow, quite by accident. So these are the kinds of things that we looked at, and it is these experiences and some others that really turned me on to psychology. Forensic psychology, as you saw the boring definition, the real definition is dealing with the criminal element and trying to get into the bits and bobs and little details of exactly why they do what they do and how to treat them. You know, and I don't mean treat well or poorly, I mean treat as in rehabilitate. Forensic psychology for me is really where it's at. Neuropsychology is pretty cool too, learning about the brain and brain biology and all that stuff, because we're finding out that a lot of mental health problems, wait for it, are caused by the brain, right? So if you have a mental health problem, it's got to be mental, it's up in your head. I went through a course during the academy, the Secret Service Academy, where it was a three-week block called protective intelligence. And what that means is that anybody that would do harm to the president in any way or any one of our protectees, we would guard foreign leaders that came to U.S. soil as well. Anybody that wanted to do harm to one of our protectees, we had to know how to grab this person, how to interview them, how to talk to them, and how to elicit information without violating rules. A lot of us, when we think about interview and interrogation, we think about the two-legged stool with a 30-watt light bulb above your head. It is not like that, let me tell you. You want it to be sometimes, but it's not. So they brought in some psychiatrists from St. Elizabeth's Medical Center in Washington, D.C. And they had them dress in character, and they told us, you're dealing with a real mentally ill person who has committed a crime, a forensic population. And they said, so be careful. We know this is just training, and we're going to be right there, but this is the real deal. So I walk out with my partner for the first scenario, and we had to go interview this guy, and he was, I don't know, about 65 years old, scruffy, dare I say ugly, smelly, frumpled, looked like they just pulled him off of the street after a 10-year stint of living there. We sat down and we started talking to him, and gaining information from this man was nearly impossible because he was afflicted with various different mental maladies that stopped us from getting the information. He didn't really understand what we were trying to say. He understood what he wanted to do, and in this particular scenario, he knew exactly where we were going to be, what the schedule of the president was. He knew the last couple of trips the president had taken, but when you started asking him personal questions, he just fizzled into nothing. What's wrong with that picture? If he's so articulate, now I didn't know this then, but if he's so articulate at being able to tell me things like presidential schedules, that means that he has some kind of mental capability to gather intelligence, right? If he has the ability to tell me finite details and he can look me in the eye and do that, that means that when he fizzles out, when I ask him other questions, that means that he's probably putting on a ploy. I didn't know that then. So you have to get really good at body language. You have to really understand what you're looking at. Body language is amazing. Well over 80% of our communication is done by body language. I'm communicating to you right now. I'm trying to take a professorly pose, Dr. Lipinski. But you were talking to me and I'm talking to you. I could stand up here completely silently and we would still communicate if I looked around the room. The same is true of this guy. If I knew what I was looking for, I maybe could have asked in a little different fashion, maybe a little bit more enthusiastically, to elicit information. But I didn't make it. I didn't get it. So great learning exercise when they call, exercise is over, your interrogation is done several hours later. The guy takes off his hat and scrubs his face a little bit, and he's a psychiatrist from St. Elizabeth's. He was not some dangerous criminal. So I should have known that too, right? So body language, what can we tell from that? If 80% of what we say to each other is nonverbal, what does that mean? Well, if we start with the 20% or more or less that is verbal, we hear it, we process it in our brain, it goes, from this little spot above your ear, actually it goes in your ear, and then this little spot above your ear, and then it kind of bounces around to different spots in the brain before your brain really comprehends it and understands it and is able to respond to it. Okay, cool. So that's a neurological process. So what's that other 80%? Look at my hands right now. What am I doing? I'm sitting here kind of gripping them. This is what I do when I concentrate. When I think, I get really relaxed. If it's a high-stress environment, things really slow down for me. Other people, when you get in a high-stress environment, the blood goes out of your head for the fight-or-flight syndrome, and it kind of gets pulled into your core to survive, and you get ready to run or you get ready to fight or flight. As you train it and you understand how that biological process works, things slow down. The adrenaline actually acts like a stimulant, which it is, and you can think more clearly and you can see more clearly, which really helps as a police officer out on the streets because you can then begin to look for what is coming at you and predict what is going to happen based on all nonverbal responses. So, we'll start at the very basic elementary level. As I look out across the room here, I see a couple of people with arms folded. I see everybody staring at me. It makes me nervous. I sweat. Why did the microphone just go up weird right there? I see people doing things with their mouth. I see folks that are hot and they're doing this with their envelopes or their flyers. I see a lot of things. What does it mean? I have no clue. I don't know you. I don't know what your baseline is. So if I was going to look into the crowd, I can only tell generalities. I can tell people are hot. People are interested. There's a few people that stayed up way too late last night and probably need to be in bed right now. There are people that, are here for the extra credit. I used to do that. There are people that, may be out there that are trying to figure out exactly what it is that I'm trying to say and say, just get to the point, would you? We have all of that in this room, and I'm seeing that from here. I'm looking out, people sitting on the ground, people standing back there. It's amazing. It's amazing to see. So how can I pick you out if you are a threat? Well, people act slightly, just ever so slightly differently when they are going to try to attack or to do something wrong. And the way that I know that is because you're trying to act like everybody else is around you. And so when you try to do something, your body doesn't let you do it unless it's really interested in it. And so if you have a gun and the president was standing here and you had an intent of coming up here and attacking him, or as we saw with President Bush in Iraq, maybe taking off your shoes and throwing them. Those guys got fired, by the way. We should be able to tell if we're paying attention. And the key is paying attention, because you never know what you're going to miss if you're not looking for it. So I don't know what I'm looking for. I just know that whatever it is slightly different. Now, let's see if we can see if I can get this to work. I've never done this before. Okay, hold up. So here, what we have is President Kennedy. He is on a trip, and he goes out to make an impromptu speech, which is our worst nightmare. President Clinton was notorious for this. He would walk out of a building, look around, and if he saw a crowd, he went right to it. Trying to keep him in the car was impossible. If you're driving down the road and he saw a crowd, he would make you stop the car so he could get out and press the flesh and say, shake some hands. President Bush, not so much. President Bush, you could set your clock by him. Once he was buttoned up in the motorcade, he was going, and no stopping, no deviations. He always did what we asked. Of course, 9/11 changed a lot of that, changed the way that he viewed his protection, and in fact, all former presidents and President Obama included, who I've never worked with. So let's look at this. Can we kill the lights for a second, please? I don't know how is the sound on up here? Anybody? Okay. So we'll hope it is. Okay, so take a look. A lot of blurry people, old camera, but it's moving kind of slow. Here comes the president. He's like, oh, hey, a crowd. Look at that. You can hear him cheering. Let me tell you something about that cheer. When a president walks out and you hear people go insane like he's a rock star, it's invigorating. It really lets you know that people respect your position and that they're excited to see you. They're excited to see living history. And so these people are going absolutely crazy because the President of the United States... Just take a watch. Tell me what you see in the face of you. What do you hear? What are we hearing? We're hearing some girl have a meltdown. What else are we hearing? Crazy lady. We see a lot of people reaching. We see a lot of people wanting to shake his hand, and we see people that don't get their hand shaken, and they're upset, and we see everybody is smiling. Look at this one lady right up here. She is on fire, man. She is seeing the president, and she's on fire, and this is before they knew all about him. The president is a rock star, and so watch a little bit more. Now that we know, we're listening, we're watching, we're seeing, tell me what more you see.
The President of the United States. But we appreciate your welcome. This city is a great Western city.
Look at the guys in the background. This guy right here is kind of smiling. This guy is smiling. It's really hard to hide joy. Really hard. It's really hard to hide anger, too. I mean, we learn if we're married or we're in a long-term relationship, we know what that means. God bless us all. But it's really hard to hide your emotion when you have an intent to do something. So see if you can see anybody. I won't give away the show here. Watch expression.
Attention to the left, count oil on the left. Yes, believe in the faith of this city, faith of this state, and faith of this country.
Darn it. Okay, so let's watch it again. Darn it! Did I tell you I get nervous? Stop! Okay, we're going to back up a little more because I'm not... Okay, there we go. All right. What do we see here? Do you see joy? Tell me some of the expressions that you see on these faces. Excitement. Yeah. Happiness. Wonder. Do you see anybody that looks a little PO'd? Guy on the right. Bet you he's Secret Service. All right. We're not good at... they tell us to don't show any expression at all. It's a dead giveaway. It's horrible. All right.
You come to see Jaffe or the president?
I came to see the president, and I said to the president, God bless you, and I meant it.
She looked like she needed a sandwich. I do too. So that's what we see, but think about it on a grand scale. Let me give you another example. I promise I'll tell some Bush and Reagan stories too. And I liked every one of these guys. They each had their own endearments, and they each had really neat qualities. But I liked every one of these guys, but Bill Clinton was one of a kind for a whole bunch of reasons. When we were in London, and this is after he left office, we had a small motorcade, 7 cars. We had a motorcycle lead and a motorcycle tail. We had a couple of Brits with us, and off we went, and he went to go to a upstairs pub that they'd cleared out so he could meet with members of his staff that since he'd left office. The room was very full. And so we pulled up, and there was nobody there, nobody out on the sidewalk, and we go upstairs, and nobody knew we were there. But the Brits are weird. Do we have any Brits in here? Okay, well, cool. I'm from British ancestry, so. The Brits will stand there for no particular reason, and they see a motorcade, and they don't know who's in there. They'll just start gathering. And then the Brits see a crowd, and they think that's cool, so they're like, hey, there's a crowd. Let's stand there and watch the crowd. We went in 30 minutes from no one outside to a crowd of 5,000. 5,000 people in 30 minutes, by word of mouth, by looking. So they asked me to go downstairs and kind of get a pulse on the motorcade and to kind of see what was happening. And I walked outside, and several excited people said, who's in there? And so I said, Michael Jackson. And the crowd got bigger. More little people. So when the president came out, we didn't have any barricades. Has anybody ever been to New York City and been to a public event? They have these bike racks that will stop an elephant. And it's really cool to see. Not here. We had a spool of yellow twine. And that's what we had to keep the crowd back. And guess what President Clinton did? He came out, people realized who it was, and what does he do? Goes straight for the crowd. Some guy yells at the top of his lungs. He says, hey, nice tie, Bill. And the president said, yeah, thank you, you know, however he speaks. And so people were interacting with him. And it was surreal because there were only, I'm not going to tell you how many of us there were. There were enough to take care of a problem, but not enough to take care of 5,000 people. And when we walked up, we had this twine, and we put it in front of people, and they're not like cattle. If they see twine, they go for it and push. So before too long, the president was completely encircled. And the detail leader was yelling in our headpieces, come on, create a hole, we need to get out of here. And so what he did is he walks up right behind the president, he sticks his hand down the back of the president's pants, and he grabbed a hold. Guess why? Because if something goes wrong and the shots start, you need to be able to direct him. And there are two places that I can grab you that are going to have a major effect on you. You guys are nasty. Because that's not one of them. If I have control of your waist, you're going to go wherever I throw you. If I have control of your head, you're going to go wherever I put you. One is more effective than the other. It depends on the situation. If I'm protecting you, I'm going to get your waist. I'm going to get you by the scruff of your pants. I can lift you off the ground. I can rush you wherever I want you to go. You can go kicking and screaming. I don't care. But your feet will never touch the ground in the event of an emergency. You won't even know what hit you until we're driving away. Well, you know I hit you because I'm a big dude. All right. And so we're ready. You know, the Brits help us create a hole, and we got out of there. So you got to be ready for anything, but you really have to be aware of a multi-stimulus environment. And this is true with police officers as well. You have to know that you're looking for something, but you don't know what it is you're looking for. But you have to know it when you see it. Yikes. It's pretty easy. did you hear that chick screaming in there in our film? That lady, excuse me, I'm sorry. Did she sound like she had ill intent, or did she sound like she was meeting somebody of, I don't know, who's a new rock star that you kids listen to these days? I don't know, Kylie Minogue? No, that's my era. Whatever, whoever. You two. No, that's not it either. She didn't have any ill intent, did she? But she was screaming at the top of her lungs. Normally when somebody screams at the top of their lungs, it's going to get your attention, and you're really going to pay a lot of attention to that. What about the lady that wanted a sandwich? The one at the end. Did she have any ill intent? Of course, the president wasn't standing right in front of her, but did you see the glow on her face? It was like somebody took some rouge and some makeup and created a Hollywood actor. She was just some lady off of the street. That was pretty cool. And so that's, you're watching history being made when you're standing up there and you're watching these things and you get to see them live. Where things really get to be a pucker factor is when something goes wrong. There have been a couple of occasions that did not hit the news where things have gone wrong. And we do everything we can to protect the first family from them knowing that something has gone wrong. We want them to have as normal of a life as possible. We want them to feel safe. We don't want them to hide from us, which the Monica Lewinsky case did more damage to us, the Secret Service, than it ever did to Bill Clinton, because we were forced to testify in court. The Supreme Court said, yeah, you have to testify. And so guys had to get up there and they had to tell secrets. We have to keep those secrets. Foreign leaders, when they come over here, they are not, they're not exactly altar boys. You know, they're normal people. They live normal lives. I've been around when somebody goes behind a door and you hear a little snorting sound. You know, they're snorting cocaine or they're having call girls or guys, whatever their thing is, come in and out of the suite, and I'm standing there guard. We can't talk about that, and we're never going to talk about it. I signed a non-disclosure agreement when I left the Secret Service saying I would not speak about the things that I had seen for 50 years, 50. So by then, I'm probably not going to be of much use talking. So things going wrong, other than the helicopter incident. I was protecting Hosni Mubarak on one of his many trips to Washington, D.C., the now deposed president of Egypt. And I was working his shift. I was a fairly junior agent, new to protection. And so my job one day would be to drive the Suburban behind the limousine package. And then the next day, I would go into what we call the well. It's the back of the Suburban. We flip the window open, and I've got a submachine gun back there, an MP5 with armor-piercing rounds ready to go. And so that particular day, we call that the number five spot. I was working the number five spot back in the well. We were at Blair House, which is an executive mansion across the street from the White House. And we were waiting for him to come out. There were protesters in Lafayette Park, right across the street from the White House, anti-Mubarak protesters. They were upset with him about Israel. They were upset with him about domestic policy, human rights. They were upset with him about the kind of sandwich he ate for lunch. Sometimes people don't care. They hate you because of who you are and what you stand for. And so a lot of people wanted to do him harm. So when a protectee gets ready to come outside of a building, we'll hear it that, hey, we have an imminent departure. And so I was standing there with a senior supervisor who was there in the Reagan days. He was on the Reagan detail, presidential detail. And the White House chief of protocol came up and grabbed my suit jacket, and she said, she points over to the press pen. The press were on either side, just like with Ronald Reagan when he walked out of the Washington Hilton. They were standing on either side, and she says, I don't know that guy. And she points to him. Guess what? The guy snaps his head, and he looks at me. And just briefly, we made eye contact. And I turned to say something to the supervisor, hey, we're going to go in and get this guy out of the press pen and escort him out and figure out what his deal is. And the guy snapped fast and took off running. As President Mubarak was walking out. We had the Egyptian security detail there. So, no harm, no foul if we lose two guys. They could jump in the motorcade and go, or go back inside Blair House and shut the door and button up, whatever they had to do. But the most dangerous time for us is during an arrival or a departure, because that's when we're most vulnerable. That's when our protectee is actually standing closest to the public. So I get in a foot chase with this guy, with the Reagan guy as well. The two of us chase this guy off of Pennsylvania Avenue, and he headed, I don't remember my directions, but he headed northbound. He took a right, and I'm in a coat and tie. We're sprinting after the guy, and we're slowly catching up to him. That was, 75 pounds ago. And we got him. You know what? I was keyed up. That adrenaline that I was talking about, where you think you're calm, cool, and collected, hadn't kicked in yet. The adrenaline had kicked in, but the calm, cool, collected part had not. And so I cranked this guy up. You know, they teach us these nice little light touches, because the Secret Service is going to be on camera anytime that anything happens. And so when we have to tune someone up, we do it with our fingers and pressure points so that it doesn't look so violent. The person will go, ah, and we're barely touching them. And that's why we do that. So I didn't do that. I tackled the guy, and the supervisor got there afterwards, and we wrestle around for a second. We get him handcuffed, and I am angry. I'm angry that this guy made it past several checkpoints. I'm angry that he was not credentialed. I am angry that he ran away. I'm just angry all the way around. So I really get a hold of this guy's wrist, and we stand him up, and he goes up on his tippy toes, and he's hollering and shouting. And we walk him back towards Pennsylvania Avenue and hand him off to a protective agent. And my heart rate didn't slow down for, I don't know, a good 2 hours. Got back in the well, and we took off. The point is that I wasn't looking for anything. This is the press pen. They've been through 3 checkpoints to be able to get to me. They're standing no more than 20 feet away from a leader of the free world. And can you imagine if that guy had gotten, if Mubarak had gotten killed then anyway? My goodness, that would have changed history, literally. And it would have been on my shoulders, all of us, all of my partners. And so those things happen. And those are the times that you really learn from. I learned a lot in the academy. I learned a lot from standing post. I learned a lot from pushing a patrol car around. I learned a lot from being a crew commander and leading people. But my learning curve when something goes wrong is huge, 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 huge. I got much better that night on learning how to read people. I spent some time soul searching, and what did I miss? How did I miss it? Why didn't I see this? You know, what could have happened? Could have, would have, should have. And did some soul searching and hit the street again the next day, and everything was fine. So the body language is really big. Now we have, I'm going to talk for about another 25 minutes or so, and then maybe 15 to 20, and then we'll open it up for questions. I want to talk about a little bit about, what do we have here? Lying. Interview and interrogation. I am not going to give away the farm on that, because there's a lot of trade secrets in there, but I am going to give you some generalities. I'm going to talk a little bit about how we do that. There's a difference between interview and interrogation. Interview is we're gathering the facts, we're talking to you, we don't know everything, and we're trying to figure it out. An interrogation is, we know it, we're just trying to get you to say it, okay? So how do you, how can you tell when someone is lying to you, to your face? It happens so much to every one of us every day. It happens to us at home, it happens to us at school, it especially happens in bars, and it happens with us. How do you tell? What is it that we might be looking for, all of us, if somebody's lying to us? Say again? Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
May sweat.
May sweat. Yeah. Up and left. Yeah. Yeah, up and left. Yeah. So all of these things are true, every one of them. So let's say you go home to your loved one and you were supposed to pick up cat food on the way home and you decided that you didn't want to do it and you willfully disobeyed your spouse and said, screw it. So you said, well, funny thing about that cat food, I was in an accident, rollover, huge accident on the way home, and I had to extract myself out of the car. And then once I got out of there, I put the fire out with my bare hands. And then the firemen came up and interviewed me because they think I'm so cool. And I roller skated home. I mean, that's an extreme example, but that's obviously a lie. How do you know when someone close to you is lying? Ah, nice one, nice one. Beautiful. Who said that? Good. Oh, dear. Okay, well, we'll have some therapy afterwards. I do that too. We know for some of our spouses, it's too much detail. That's a common lying technique because what you do is you come up with this really cool story ahead of time, and then when it's time to recite it, you recite the whole story. And you tell me everything that I didn't want to know. Don't care. All I want to know is you didn't get the cat food. I got to go up to 7-Eleven now. All right? So too much detail. Yeah, that's a common one. Any other ideas? Can't say it again backwards. I'm going to have to try that out. That sounds cool. I've heard of that. Yeah, yeah. Right. Story changes. Backwards, story changes. Story changes, yeah, that happens a lot. It's really hard to keep details straight, even when you build this complex story in your head. So your spouse starts saying, you know, I don't quite believe you. Tell me a little bit more about putting the fire out with your hands. Oh, crap, I didn't think about that. Well, I wasn't wearing gloves. I just cut my fingernails. You know, the fire wasn't very hot at all. You know, whatever. But you know. I'm going to bring up a controversial subject in here, especially for guys, women's intuition. It works, let me tell you. Let me tell you. Why is that? Because statistically, women are a little bit more empathic than guys. Women look for smaller details than guys. Women listen for tonal inflections in the voice. Ladies can be naturally suspicious. I'm going to back right out of that one. My bad. Okay. Jeez, it's hot again. But, you know, it's true. Ladies, when they, especially when they have a child or they have a little brother or sister, they spend a lot of time getting to know the life cycle of that child and what the baseline is. And so when the little child comes up and tugs on mom's skirt and says whatever, and they tell their little white lie, mom knows. Mom knows. How does mom know? I don't know. But mom knows, right? Dads pick up on it too. We're not too bad. I'm not a dad, but we're not too bad at this sort of thing. It's because we're picking up on subtle differences in what the person's telling us. Now, if I meet you for the first time and I'm going to talk to you for a minute, then I can probably start to pick up on a few things. But if I've known you my whole life, or I've known you for, you know, more than a week or two, a couple of weeks, I kind of get an idea of what you're like day to day. And if that changes from day to day, I know whether you're ill, whether you are having a bad intent to lie to me. I know when you're feeling good. I know when you're going to throw a surprise party for me. We can tell those sorts of things. So how does that relate to a forensic sense? How do we know that when we have somebody in front of us who is purposely trying to throw us off our tracks? Guess what? It's the same thing, the exact same thing. If your gut tells you something, it's probably right. You know why? Because your gut is the culmination of your five senses. Your brain is picking up on something in your subconscious mind that you're not seeing yet. You're not understanding yet. But it's flashing a signal down into your stomach muscles saying, something's odd. Something's odd. And so we look for changes. Is there a volunteer out in the crowd that would be willing to come up here? Both of you, come on up. So I've been keeping an eye on these two. I've been keeping an eye on everybody, but I've really been keeping an eye on these two. And you can come stand right behind the table here. Thank you for volunteering. I appreciate it. Mirroring. That's another thing. Mirroring. What's your name?
Pearl.
Pearl. Nice to meet you, Pearl. And
Edward.
Oh. Nice to meet you, Edward. Oh. Okay. How do you feel standing up in front of this crowd? Look out. Don't look at me. Look at the crowd. Smile.
Hi.
Hi, everybody. How do you feel? How do you feel?
I'm fine. Crowds don't bother me very much.
Okay. That's good. That's good. How about you? Two thumbs up. Okay. You're not in the least bit nervous to stand up here?
Maybe a little bit.
How can I tell that?
Because I can tell that I'm sweating, so you can probably see that.
Okay. Did you guys see this? Did we see that? Now she put, see? Are you nervous?
No.
Not at all?
No.
Have you ever been nervous in front of a crowd?
Yeah, a long time.
And what happened then? Can't remember. The story ran out. And this is the truth. And this is the truth. You know, we have someone who, as soon as I pointed something out, you know, immediately changed. We have someone who is leaning up against the table, you know, acting very relaxed, and probably is very relaxed. But this is a baseline of what we might see and look for. So now that you're up here and you guys have looked at the crowd, your attention and focus is kind of back on me, right? It's easier to look at me than it is to look at you guys because there's 200 plus of you, and there's one of me, and so that's cool. I appreciate that because you're proving a point. Thank you very much. You guys can have a seat. Thank you. Once they get back to their seat, can we dim the lights, please? What was cool there is there were subtle changes. Went from sitting in the audience to coming up here and being on the stage. And so there were physiological changes that they could not control. I don't care how hard you try, your breathing is going to change, your sweat response is going to change, your respiration is going to change, and then your affect of how you're looking at me is going to change. Let's watch some classic clips here.
But I want to say one thing to the American people. I want you to listen to me. I'm going to say this again. I did not have sexual relations with that woman. Miss Lewinsky, I never told anybody to lie, not a single time, never. These allegations are false, and I need to go back to work for the American people. Thank you.
I take responsibility for all my actions, both public and private, and that is why I'm speaking to you tonight. As you know, in a deposition in January, I was asked questions about my relationship with Monica Lewinsky. While my answers were legally accurate, I did not volunteer information. Indeed, I did have a relationship with Ms. Lewinsky that was not appropriate. In fact, it was wrong. It constituted a critical lapse in judgment and a personal failure on my part for which I am solely and completely responsible. But I told the grand jury today, and I say to you now, that at no time did I ask anyone to lie, to hide or destroy evidence, or to take any other unlawful action. I know that my public comments and my silence about this matter gave a false impression. I misled people, including even my wife.
Lights, please. What do we think about that? That's intense. We're watching the most powerful man in the free world lie. Now, what I'm going to do is, let's take a look at some body language. And the only reason I'm using this is because I know the guy. Knew him. Kind of. Well, he didn't know me, but I knew him. Look at bottom lip. He's tucking it in. Where is he looking? Down. What kind of expression does he have on his face? Yeah, ashamed. I'm trying to figure out exactly what I'm going to say. What kind of defense did he offer? An emphatic defense. He said, I did not have sexual relations with that woman. Did he call her Monica Lewinsky? No. He said, I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. So he's distancing himself from the entire situation. And he said, you know what? This isn't even worth my time. I need to get back to work for the American people. Now, for those of us that were around during this, what were you thinking when you watched it? Yeah, and you're not a trained interrogator. I did too. That was really uncomfortable. How about when he apologized? Tell me a little bit about his facial expression there. Blinking a lot, good. What else? Eyebrows, yeah. Face is relaxed, yeah. You can see his bottom lip. He's a little skinnier. His hair is a little grayer. And he's looking directly into the camera. Now, this was practiced. I guarantee and I promise you that when they did things like this at the White House, and still when they're getting ready for various different debates, they lock themselves into a room. No one is allowed in except for the chief of staff and maybe one or two other advisors. The Secret Service can't go in. Of course, no opposition, and they will go at it. You hear shouting and all sorts of things. So when the president stepped out and he made this speech here, it was practiced. But as soon as you tell the truth, even one time, even a little bit, you get the psychological relief, like, oh, I don't have to keep up this front anymore. I just told the truth. You may keep your story going for a long time, but that's something that we watch during interrogation. We watch to see what the difference is when we start probing and we ask you a question and we touch on something when we've hit something. I can tell just pretty much by looking at you, not always. I did 103 interrogations. I got confessions in 101 of them. Half of those were written confessions. And I didn't do it with a baseball bat and a two-legged stool. I sat down and I had a conversation. The two that I didn't get a confession from was a homeless man that wanted to go to prison because that's where he came from and that's what he knew. And then the other one, the homeless guy was trying to actually admit to something worse. The other one was a pissed off housewife. And there was no way I was going to get anything out of her. Yeah. But I did an interrogation up in Big Bear, California. We got a call of a guy that had been stealing computers and then stealing identities off the computers. And they found some counterfeit cash on him when they arrested him. Counterfeit cash, Secret Service protects the financial infrastructure of the United States. We're the primary on that. And so went up to chit-chat with him. And, I always looked the part, so I'd put on a coat and tie and drop my 80-pound belt that I'm wearing right now to fake you guys out. And walk into the room, and I look every bit the part. Oh, shit, the Secret Service is here. And so I walk in and I close the door and I said to him, first thing I said was, you know what? I already got their story outside. I know what the deputy said about you. I've read their reports. I had a telephone conversation with them on the hour drive up here. So I know everything there is to know about what they have to say about you. What I don't know is what you have to say about you. So there's two sides to every story. I have to make a decision right now whether to charge you federally in federal court and have you serve a longer sentence or to let them take care of it and you may serve a lighter sentence. Now, before I Mirandize you and before I start talking to you and asking you questions, I want you to be very clear about what my role is. I'm here as a decision maker. I'm not here to jam you up. Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody has bad days. Everybody needs money because their kids are hungry or because their parents are sick. All right? So I get that already. I'm not looking for an angel. I'm just looking for you to tell me a little bit of truth. Okay? You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. Da-da-da-da-da-da. So we started, and I didn't know anything about him. Had not made phone calls, had not done any of that. Perfectly legal for me to say that. And we started asking questions. And so one of the few techniques I'll tell you is in this particular situation, I pretended like I knew more than I did. Look at my body language right now. What am I doing? I just hid behind the podium. My hand is gripping the side, and I'm trying to take a position of authority. Why? Because there are a couple of police officers in the room. And guess what? Probably don't want me to be talking a whole lot about this subject, and I won't. But it's my way of putting this between me and the folks out there that don't want me to say anything. Where have I been all night? Up to this side of the podium, kind of out in front, right? And so it's those little, tiny, subtle details, whether it's in an interview or an interrogation or whether you're looking into a crowd or you're looking into your spouse's face, it's the little, tiny things that are going to give you the biggest clues and the biggest hints. Now, I do not want to cause marital problems, all right? For every spouse or loved one that is lied to, there is a spouse that's really good at doing it, you know? And we don't want to cause any problems. So I don't want you to leave tonight thinking that, okay, I'm going to go look at YouTube, I'm going to watch Bill Clinton, and then I'm going to go talk to my husband. Crap. So let's watch one more short here. I haven't seen this one. Somebody recommended it to me.
My mom's really tough. I mean, she had a stroke when she...
Aren't we all? Ah, Bill Gates.
Bill Gates and Charlie Rose are both celebrities in different respects.
Are you kidding me?
It is this celebrity status that allows them to overcome certain distractions.
Oh, I'm
going to
overcome
speak.
Your distraction by clicking you off, idiot. Jeez, lights, please. Wow, that was bad. I'm sorry. My Argosy student friend that gave that to me, we're going to have some words. Okay. So, kind of what we've talked about tonight is we've told some stories and we have talked about some of the subtleties of your five senses, how they work. We've talked about maybe how you can catch somebody lying to you. It's because they're slightly off a baseline. It's the exact same concept that I used when I was standing next to the podium with a sitting president of the United States. It is the skills that I did not use the night with, or the morning with, Hosni Mubarak. We've talked about a little bit about questioning. We've looked at some people, and they came up here. What kinds of questions do you have? All right. Yes, sir.
I was just wondering, I've heard a little bit about how lie detectors can get beat.
Yes.
I was wondering, in any of your research, if you've seen, if they've started to do any research into brain scanning with blood flow, like the creative side of the brain for liars.
Yes. That's a very good question. The question is about polygraphs, how they work, and then brain scans. If we can put a little cap on top of your head and see if you're lying. The answer is yes. That's been around for quite some time. Your head generates an electrical field within just a couple of millimeters of your skull. And much like an x-ray, if we put some sensors on it, we can not read your thoughts, but we can see what parts of your brain are firing up. Now, if I put you in a functional MRI machine and I run you in there and then I ask you to start telling me fibs all day long, different parts of your brain are going to light up versus when you're lying versus when you're telling the truth. Okay, so that technology already exists and it has for some time. The reason we don't use it is think about the civil implications and the privacy implications of putting a skull cap on somebody and virtually knowing what parts of their brain are firing and saying, you're lying. Think about that. Would you want that on you? No, absolutely not. Does it get used? Yes, not for common purposes. Polygraph, on the other hand, is the lie detector. Guess what? It does not detect lies. I hate these things. I've hated them since I took my first one because they don't work. What a polygraph machine does is it detects physiological changes in your body. It detects sweat response in your actually this finger or this one. It detects your breathing rate. It detects your blood pressure. And then the person sitting behind the machine looking at the screen interprets that data. And what they're going to do is they're going to stress you out on purpose by asking you some silly questions first that really embarrass you, and they're going to see what you look like when you're under a state of stress. Then they're going to start asking you questions that they care about. Are you a thief? Or, you know, have you ever divulged classified information? That sort of thing. And they're going to see how that compares to when they asked you about your first sexual experience as a teenager. And they're going to compare the two. And so the theory is that I'm going to be nervous telling you about my sexual experience, but if I am telling you the truth about not divulging classified information, then it's not going to ping. Well, yeah, it will. It will. The body's a funny thing. When the body gets nervous, everything just goes to poop. No pun intended. We sweat. We breathe differently. We look differently. We feel differently when we're under stress. It's because that adrenaline response that's flowing into our head is causing a physiological response in our body because we're nervous. Now, can you beat the machine? Yes. One of the ways that you can beat it is believe your own lie. If you practice enough and you believe your own lie, it's a very long process to be able to do this, but we teach all of our foreign intelligence agents how to beat those things. You know, so yeah, you can beat them. I did one. There was a question back here somewhere? Yes, ma'am. Phenomenal question. One word, humor. I play practical jokes and I'm a really funny guy. I like to think I am because I crack myself up. You bring up a very important point. Over the course of a career, any first responder will tell you that there is a cumulative effect of trauma that you can go to one murder scene and you're okay. You can go to a bombing. One of the things that I did in the Secret Service that I didn't talk about tonight was I was on an advanced team for 2 years, and my specialty was explosives, and maybe I did tell you earlier. So I had to learn how to blow things up, and you go through one explosion, the guys, the veterans who have been downrange, and you hit a vehicle-borne IED, which is a homemade bomb. If your mouth is open, you're going to feel more of a ding than if your mouth is closed. And that's because the blast wave comes through your mouth, through your sinuses, and right up into your frontal lobe of your brain. And the frontal lobe controls executive function. It controls the filter, when we're supposed to say things and when we're not. It's the same thing for a police officer. If the soldier goes through 10 of those explosions or more, they're going to act much differently than if they go through one. So if, as a police officer or as a special agent, I go to 10 trauma scenes, I'm going to act much differently than if I go to one. And so all those things build up over the years, and we're very good at keeping ourselves closed off, because guess what? Same thing in the military. If you call 911 and it doesn't work, who else are you going to call? Okay? Well, let's say they're busy. you're not gonna call anybody else. 911 is it. We are it. If we can't show up and solve your problem, it's not gonna get solved. Same thing with a trauma physician. If you go to the ER and you've been in a horrible accident and he can't fix you, you're not getting fixed. So who else do you call? And that's an enormous responsibility. So humor, talking to fellow cops who really know what I've been through. Exercise is a good one, but I missed the boat on that one. And just socializing. I'll tell you one of the best ways that I can do it is when I'm on duty, I'm on duty. When it was time to pick up the gun or strap on the gun and go out and do my job, I did it. But I learned early on in my career to hang it up and to go home and to be with my loved ones. So I didn't hang out with a lot of people from work. I didn't surround myself with cops. If I had problems, I did. But I learned a completely different life. So that was a great coping mechanism. Great question. Anybody else? Oh, sure. If you want a job in law enforcement, there's room for you. There's a lot of law enforcement jobs because there's so many categories of law enforcement. If you don't want to be a cop and you want to, say, go into forensic psychology, you want to go into crime scene processing, you want to go into polygraph, you want to go into evidence collection, there are so many civilian positions. Most of them are science-based, I'll tell you that. And that's the way psychology is going. We're getting away from the foofy therapy, how do you feel thing, and we're getting into your brain, and we're figuring out what's going in your brain. Because if we do a direct intervention on your brain, I didn't mean to hit my fist when I said intervention. If we do an intervention on your brain, then we have a much better chance of healing you and helping you. And so science is where it's at. Neuroscience. If I had to, 6 or 7 years ago, redo my degree, I would have done the exact same thing that I'm doing now. If I have to pick up a second PhD, it's going to be in neuroscience, because that is the new frontier. Another question? Yes, sir. Most interesting case or job? For in protection. Well, I'll give you two. I was protecting 43, George Bush Jr., and we were in Fargo, North Dakota, and I'd been working the advanced site. We were in a big stadium, and this was prior to 9/11. He was pushing a big, I don't know, tax break or something. And he was going to speak in the middle of the stage, and so I set armor up around the stage and hung, you know, red, white, and blue bunting from it and all that, but it was really armor plates. The blue goose that you see, the big, tall blue podium, is also armored. So if something goes wrong, we can throw him right into that. That's all the secrets I'm giving out on that one. But the president, right before he went on, I was backstage with him. And it's like a football team right before they run out. Everybody is getting in the zone. He was kind of pacing back and forth, and you could see this intense look on his face. And as soon as they announced, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, and they started playing Ruffles and Flourishes and Hail to the Chief, he walks out, and he walked out on a stage that was just about 4 inches smaller than this, about as wide as this, all the way out to the middle of the stadium where the Blue Goose was to give a speech. Lining that trail were young members of the North Dakota Air National Guard, and they were all no older than 21. And we took their guns away, so they felt bad, so they were just standing there and looking sharp and holding American flags. And you know what he did? He stopped along the way, and he said to every one of them, he leaned down, grabbed their shoulder, and whispered in their ears, they stood at attention, thank you for your service. And he went from side to side to side as the crowd was just going nuts. And to see that kind of humility from a sitting commander-in-chief was just amazing. That was really something to see. Because then I got to see the kids as they came off stage, because I was backstage. Oh my goodness, you know, that's something they'll remember for the rest of their lives. With Bill Clinton, this was pretty cool. We were in Dublin. We were in, I forget which hotel. And he was having lunch with Julio Iglesias. Really cool lunch. And I was standing outside the door, And so I heard the door rattle, and the president and Julio come out, and the president walks him down the hallway to the elevator. We'd secured the entire floor, top floor of this hotel. And, you know, I hadn't been on his detail for quite some time, and they all know you by sight. They really don't know a whole lot about you or your name. They just know that you're around. Mrs. Reagan was an exception. And he walks up to me, and he puts his hands on his hips. He just starts shaking his head like this. He goes, man, you should have seen that guy's black book. His little address book with all the girls' telephone numbers in it. He said, I sure wish I had that. Mr. President, I do too, I suppose. So, you know, it's little personal moments like that. It's not the ones that you would think that really stick with me. It's the little tiny things that that are human moments that really stick with me. So, good question. Thank you. Anybody else? How about back over there? And then we'll come to you.
First off, sir, we'd all like to thank you for your service.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you. No. Life may have been in danger because these are dangerous things. So there is that possibility. What happened was the guy did not have any weapons. He got through all the magnetometers, three different sets of them. He got into the press pen, and his intention was to embarrass Hosni Mubarak by jumping out of the crowd and causing a ruckus, and then it'd be on the news, and that kind of news would trump the visit and any agenda that Mubarak had. So that's almost more damaging than an actual attack. So that's what happened to him. He went to jail. I think he's out now. He was an Egyptian national. When he got out of jail here, we sent him back to Egypt, and they took care of whatever they did there. So.
So I'm curious, after living quite the life to this point.
Thank you.
You get your doctorate in clinical psychology, what are you going to do with it?
Ooh, probably more of this. I have a real passion for combat troops, people who have, we call it downrange, who have been overseas, and who have really been in the thick of it. And I've spent quite some time not only studying, but speaking with these folks. And I really, really want to work with them. But I also, since I have an extensive background in law enforcement, both at the local level as well as the federal level, I understand them too. And so I'm going to initially do my work at the VA. I work in research now. Once I graduate and I get into my residency, I'm going to focus on neuro research. And then once that residency is done, then hopefully open up private practice and make a real difference. Vulnerable person? Oh, normal. My mom. She's pretty cool. You mean protectee-wise? Okay. Oh, that's a good question. They each have their endearments. You know, I'm going to have to go with Nancy Reagan. I worked with President Reagan right after he got sick. I got to his detail. And, you know, he had some speech problems, and he was an amazing man to work with. Nancy Reagan, if she liked you, you were in. If she doesn't like you, you're out. And she is 5 foot nothing, 90 pounds of fury, that woman. But she liked me, and you want to know why? Because she hates wearing glasses. So when she took her glasses off, I was always the tallest guy in the room, and she could see me from anywhere in the room. And so she loved me for that, and I'm a nice guy. There was a hand up over here. Yes. No, it doesn't. It's hardwired. We can untrain that, But ask, you know, ask any veteran or any cop, and they will tell you, you know, Spidey senses work forever. Yeah, for sure. So what's your follow-up question? Any regrets? I probably would have stayed in the Secret Service longer. The reason I got out is because we went to war, and I was sitting in the ready room at the Reagan residence in Bel Air, and I was eating a taco. It was a really good taco. But I saw one of my Marine Force recon friends, a really badass guy, who was being interviewed by a reporter because he was the reporter was embedded with a Marine unit, and this guy was walking around, and you know, he got on camera one step or another. The guy was covered head to toe in dirt and grime, and when he smiled, these big white pearly teeth came out. And I said, man, I got to get in the fight. I can't sit here in Bel Air. And so I went back in the Air Force. I requested a leave of absence from the Secret Service. They said, no, you either do the Secret Service or you do the military, but you can't do both. And so I chose the military, and I went and served for 2 years. So that's one regret. But I'm so glad that I did that, because that set me on the path to this. Another question. Yes, sir.
Were you talking about post-traumatic stress, the kind of work you want to do?
Oh, absolutely. Trauma work, yeah.
Are you familiar with Lee Gerst?
Yes, I am, actually. Oh, okay. Yeah, I actually became aware of them about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, and they've got some really good stuff going on. So that's something I'll investigate when I have letters after my name. There was somebody over here? Yes. It's embarrassing when that happens. I'll tell you a short story. Doesn't have to do with crowds because that's too embarrassing. I was working Christmas Day of, gosh, maybe 1994 in Anaheim. And we got a call of a stabbing in progress. It was right near Disneyland in the busiest intersection in California and probably one of the busier ones in the United States, Harbor and Catella. And they said that a guy was getting beat up in the middle of the intersection. It was 10 o'clock in the morning. It's Christmas morning. I'm like, what the? So cars start coming from all over the city, different parts of the city, and that was in my sector, so I was nearby. The people bailed when they heard the sirens, and one of the descriptions that we got was a white Toyota Camry with four Asians, two male, two female, in the car. And so as I'm rolling southbound, I see this car pass me going northbound on the other side. So I whip around, and the guy turns into Disneyland, which was closed. And I follow him up to the gate, and he sees that the gate is closed, and he swings around and starts heading right for me like he's going to crash into me. And so my blood pressure went up. And he stopped right before he hit me, and I jumped out of the car, and I had His windows were down, and I had my .45 out. And I went up to the car, and I grabbed a handful of hair, and anybody that tells you about pursuits and all that stuff, it is a rush. It is really hard to keep your cool there. And I stuck the gun right in the guy's head, and I said, you won't even hear it. I said, don't move. So, you know, people were swarming the car. We pulled everybody out. It was this big dramatic thing, and they were Japanese tourists from Tokyo. On their very first trip to the United States. Welcome to the happiest place on earth. So yeah, we're wrong sometimes. Yes. Yeah, good question. Absolutely. And I'll tell you why. Because you know, we've had, say, kids of presidents that you know, they're notorious for trying to give us the slip. They don't have the big motorcade and all the resources. They may have two or three people, and Chelsea was notorious for this when she was at Stanford. And she'd bail out a window and out she went, and, you know, we'd be looking all over for her. We don't want that to happen with the people we protect. I don't care what you do behind a closed door. As long as you're not hurting somebody else, then it's not my professional job to stop you or to comment on it, because my job is to protect you. And I will protect you at any cost, up to and including laying down my life for you, because of your historical position, not because of the kind of person that you are. So my conscience was clear. Now, I didn't have to testify. Some of my friends did. I came in a little bit after that. But I was able to go to bed every night and sleep like a baby. No problems. No, you don't think about it much. You know, and you don't run across a lot of situations where you really think you're going to die. The ones where you're going to die, you don't think about it. You know, it just sort of happens. Heart attack, car accident, you know, getting shot in combat. One common theme that people who have been in, say, Fallujah tell me is that, you know, if you already act like you're dead, then you don't have anything to worry about, and the fear goes away. And so I never really worried about it. I still don't. I worry about it more now since I've retired than I did when I was on serving actively. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
What is the process to become a Secret Service agent?
Go to usajobs.gov. Keep an eye out for the announcement. And then it's a fairly lengthy process. You have a psychological portion of your interview, you have a background, you have a polygraph that in some cases lasts several days. Mine was 9 hours. You have a lengthy background investigation. They go back to birth. They talk to elementary school teachers that I had. Yeah, I was not a good elementary school student. Almost got fired right there. You have a physical agility. So it's a lengthy process. From the time I turned my application in to the time I got hired was 2 years. It took me 2 years. Now they whittled it down to about 10 months. So, but the Secret Service has also doubled in size since I was there. You know, yes. Mm-hmm. A lot, yeah. We've learned how to deal with people that throw shoes. We became Department of Homeland Security right as I was leaving versus part of the Department of Treasury. And so we're a lot more focused on active shooter situations, school shootings, and having a predictive capability, which doesn't work worth a hill of beans. There's no science behind it. And then the way we protect people. One of the common techniques now is, especially with somebody that you may not recognize, say the King of Tonga, we're not going to have a huge car and dance and motorcade and stuff with him. What we will do is we will be in what we call a counter-surveillance mode. We'll pull back. You won't even know that we're there. The guy gets to run free, and everything is great. So that's different than when I was there. Two more questions, and then we're done. Anybody? Okay, one more question. Okay, two. There we go. Yes, sir.
Well, being apolitical.
I'm not touching that with a 10-foot pole. Maybe, maybe not. Right. Yes, sir. I have. I didn't watch it, but I have heard of it, yes.
Mm-hmm. A lot of it was from books that were written by a doctor.
I haven't seen the show, but I'll tell you this about Hollywood. The reason this room is packed out tonight is because of Hollywood. It's because of what you see on TV, and you know, you have a perception about what I do, and a lot of what I do is fun to talk about, but not fun to do. I'll tell you, being on the campaign trail in Iowa, standing out, you know, guarding an entrance next to a trash can when it's 30 degrees below zero is no fun at all. But when you say, hey, you know, George Bush is in there, or John Kerry or somebody, you know, it sounds cooler. So, yeah. All right. Well, you guys, thank you so much for spending time with me. Thank you. Thank you.